Hello everyone, my name is Naren, and in this session, let's learn about distributed computing. I think this is the third or fourth video in the series of learning distributed system, which basically helps you to get better in system design. And also these patterns will help you to solve your everyday software engineering problems. You can just learn, take these patterns and then apply it in your problems to quickly solve all of your problems. So today let's learn distributed computing. So what is distributed computing? Okay, most likely you guys would have deployed your code in one server and solved all of your problems. When it comes to distributed problem, it is refers to as when multiple systems are connected via a network, and it is used to solve bigger problems or high level problems, where generally these problems can be solved only in supercomputers. Why do we need to do so? Why can't we just use supercomputer itself? Because they are expensive. If they fail, all of your data is gone. So with this kind of design, what happens is you are basically using computers which are commodity computers, or very generic computers, which you get it for a couple of thousands of rupees or dollars, which are basically the ones which we use at our home itself. So these are very cheap, and networking cost is much cheaper also. These machines can stay in same place, or they might present in different places. Basically, they just need to connect via some network cable, or they might be in the same LAN or something like that. The good thing about this distributed computing is, for the problem giver, this system looks like one system. For example, I have a bigger problem to solve which can't be solved in one computer. I can just give it to distributed computing. It basically solves my problem. Even though that is made of, say for example, in this design we have five computers, but in general we might have thousands of computers to solve any given problem. For the problem giver, I don't even know that there are so many computers, and while I'm giving the problem, it is just like as easy as like giving it to one simple computer. So that's why distributed computing is very general or generic pattern these days, where it is used to solve higher problems. Take for example, NASA keeps on releasing a lot of images about different galaxies or Mars and everything, right? So these kind of data is not as simple as you think. Say for example, I remember NASA released one image of galaxies. The original picture was about like 1.5 gigabytes. Think about it. If the image itself is 1.5 gigabytes, the actual raw image when they got it from Hubble telescope was about, in terms of petabytes or terabytes. So you can't just save all of that into one machine. But when you have distributed computing, say for example, you can use hundreds of computers of just about like 64 GB RAM one each. So when you have hundreds of machines, you basically have about 640 GB of RAM. Basically, you are dividing a big problem into small chunks and then giving it to all of these one computer. Basically, each computer solves all of these small problems, and then finally you're going to collect the answers from all of these computers to one solution, and you have the solution for that bigger problem. And one more example for distributed computing is, say for example, you have tons of books, ebooks or documents, say for example in terms of petabytes, terabytes, or the whole library itself, or consider each and every book in the whole world, you have it in somewhere, and you basically need to count all of the words which are there in all of the books. So this is a very big problem. You can't just do it in one machine, because if you do so, it will take years of time to get that count. Even if you get that count, it's very difficult to save it in one computer also. So these kind of problems are typical problem where we actually use distributed computing, where you basically give tons of books. We basically divide books into batches, and then you give it to one machine, and then they solve that small problem. Basically, you get the count of the words in each of the machines, and then basically end of the day, we aggregate all of them, take the unique words from all of the computers and then sum the total count, so you have the answers. And who initially contributed a lot into distributed computing? You know, definitely the name comes into picture. Anyone can guess Google started it because they are the one who started to acquire a lot of data and they had a lot of data to process. They're the one who contributed a lot into distributed computing with a lot of white papers they have submitted so far with MapReduce, you know, distributed storages and a lot. So they are the key player in distributed computing. And partly, Yahoo also, helped a lot in creating a lot of distributed computing frameworks too. As I mentioned initially, Google submitted the MapReduce framework paper. The open source community took that paper of Map and Reduce, and then they built a very sophisticated framework called as Hadoop, and that is what every big data solutions architects these days are using to solve the bigger problems. I don't think there is no other framework which is better than Hadoop as of now to solve the bigger problems. Most of the Apache projects are basically part of this Hadoop framework because everyone is compatible with every other products. Say for example, Kafka, Apache Spark, Kafka Streams, Apache Storm, HDFS, HBase, Cassandra. There are so many. They are like kind of one family, which all belongs to kind of Hadoop framework, and they all can be easily connected to each other to transfer the data or save the data and move the data between these different systems. Now let's understand the very basic concept called as MapReduce, this is the very basics or the starting point of distributed computing. You need to understand this to understand any other higher level frameworks. So I'm going to explain this taking one example now. So before we understand the working of MapReduce and the importance of it, we need to understand how we would have solved the problems in traditional way. So let's solve the same problem in traditional way and also using MapReduce framework and see the difference to understand it even better. Say the problem statement is, as I've taken already, so if you have millions of books and I need to find the word count of all the unique words in all of the books. So how do I solve this? Obviously, it will be in terabytes or petabytes. So consider I have this data in one machine. So let's take this machine. So there are another four machines which is available. All are have the equal processing power or may not be. So how do I tackle this problem? To do this, I will have to use the distributed computing, but without MapReduce framework. So that's why it is called as traditionally. So distributed computing is like using a couple of more machines and all are working to solve one particular problem. So this is still a distributed computing. So, but to solve the problem without framework, it is kind of difficult, but let's try and do it. So I know I have, say, five machines. So let's split this data of 1 million books into five different pieces. So I'll have to divide this into five chunks. So this chunk, this, say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Now I'm going to send all of this chunk to all of this machine. Basically, the first chunk, maybe it stays here itself in the machine one. So chunk one is here. And the chunk two, I'm going to send it to 2. Chunk three, I'm going to send it to 3, 4, and then 5. So respectively, for simplicity. So if you see closely, I'm basically transferring a lot of data to different machines, right? Okay. And to compute the word count, obviously I would have had the code written and placed it in these machines because that's why I'm sending the data there. So I have the code here. So I have the code to compute all of this. Okay. So the code is already there. I'm just sending the data to all of these machines. So if this 1 million books was about, let's take 5 terabytes of data. That means that each chunk was about 1 terabyte. Basically, I ended up transferring 4 terabytes to all of these machines whenever I wanted to do computation. So that means every time when we have different problem, basically we have to keep on sending this data here and there to solve that problem. If it was very simple problem, maybe I would have solved it here itself. But since word count is like a difficult problem, I will have to keep on sending this data and then do this. Maybe if I keep that block of data there itself, then it would have been good. But I don't want to use all of this machine, maybe or may not be. So that's why I ended up transferring all of this data at once, and it took a lot of network toll. Okay, now I will basically execute the code here. I'll have to do it manually, so I can't do it, you know, automatically. Otherwise, I'll have to write one more script, okay? It's a lot of work. So simply I'll basically execute it here, execute it there, execute it here and here and here. And so everywhere it got executed. After some time, maybe I have the result here, I have the result here, here, here. And someone needs to collect all of this result. And who will do that? Obviously, if I'm trying to solve the problem, I'll be the one who collects all of this result. So I have the output here. Basically, I have to collect it to one machine. Maybe collect the results back to this machine, collect the result to back here, here, and here. So I have the results here. Now I need to write one more piece of code to merge all of that to compute, to get the final results of word count. So if you see a lot of manual work, right? I have to, break it, send it, whenever I have to solve the problem, I have to wait until all of this data is transferred there. And then I have to execute it, okay, in all of the machines. If I, luckily I had only 5 machines, I was able to execute. What if I had hundreds of machines? I had to go to hundreds of machines and execute everywhere. Otherwise, I have to write a script and then push it all into all of machine to automatically execute. And it's all like difficult, right? And end of the day, I'll have to write one more script to collect or aggregate all of that data. So it's like a lot of manual work. So happy scenario, we were able to get the result. But what if there were a couple of problems? Let's answer some of the problems, because these machines can fail anytime, right? Because they are just machines. They, anything can happen to any machine. What if this machine failed? Then what happens? Obviously, we can't have a final result because we had fifth chunk of the data sent over here, okay? And then if this machine was failed, then obviously the output was not here. And when we will get to know? We will only get to know in the end of the execution, or maybe when I go to check the output. Until then, I don't even know that this machine failed and we don't have the result. And the funny thing is, if I didn't save the data here, this data is lost, okay? Maybe I thought, okay, I have saved this fifth chunk of data here, so I have deleted here. If that's the case, then I lost the data. So that's one problem, right? That's the reliability problem. And there could be one more problem. Initially, I mentioned that these machines might be of equal power or might not be. What if this machine is a lot slower than any of the machine? Maybe these all had about 16 cores, but this machine had just one core. In that case, this machine might take 10 hours to compute when this machine is taking maybe 1 hour. So as a person who is waiting for the result, I don't even know, maybe this is taking this much time. I'll have to just wait until this guy is finished. Even though these all actually computed the results, I will have to still wait for another 15 hours extra just to, get this output. What if I knew earlier? Maybe I would have, given less work to this guy, more work to these other guys. So I would have got the results all at, equal time. But I have to do the calculations again based on how many cores each machines have. Then I have to change the size of the input in that way to get the results all at the same time. That's again a manual work. So I guess you guys understood the core problem of doing all of this work. This is hell, okay? This is a lot of work. I mean, maybe I have 5 machines, it might look like easy, but when we had hundreds of machines, when we want to compute, when I want to compute 100 million books results, it is very tedious. So I might be having 100 machines. I have to keep track of which machines are failing, which is slower, and how to split the data, and it's all hectic. And that's the reason why we need a proper MapReduce framework to solve the bigger order problems. So now let's see how MapReduce would have solved that problem even much more efficiently. So as I've initially mentioned, we had the data, right? So the MapReduce inherently doesn't actually allow us to save the data in one place for the, you know, first of all. So what it does is, so whenever we save some data into the, you know, clusters of, you know, computing cluster, it actually automatically distributes all of this data into these machines itself. So this distribution happens actually whenever we save itself. It doesn't actually happen when we want to try to compute. So that means whenever we are initially storing the data itself, and there will be like something like master node and data node as such, the master node will take care of, you know, distributing the data into all of the machines available in that computing cluster. So what happens now is whenever I want to save this, you know, big chunk of data, as and when I keep on writing the data, the automatically it saves chunk here, chunk of the data here, chunk of the data over here and here. And the funny thing, or not funny thing actually, the good thing about it is that it also keeps multiple copies of the data in redundant, because we want to have, you know, we never want to lose the data. So, you know, maybe chunk one was here, or, you know, and chunk one is also saved here, and, you know, two is saved here, maybe, you know, three is here, four is here, and then four and three is here. So if you see, basically we have two copies of data over here. Say chunk one is over here and here as well, and chunk two is here and here, chunk three is here and here, and four is here and here. So basically we have one more copy of the data everywhere. So okay, that way we are basically safer side. We are on the safer side. Even if some machine fails, we still have the copy of the data in other machines. So that's one good advantage. And the next thing is, whenever we want to compute the same problem, basically I want to get the word count. Now, instead of moving the data to different machines, because data is already there in the servers, now I want to basically do some computation. Now, instead of moving the data, now in this scenario, we basically moving the code from one machine to other machine. Basically, instead of going to each and every machine and, you know, running the code, what I have to do is go to the master node and submit the .py or whatever code you want to. Basically, this is the word count file or the code. I just need to tell this master node, please run this script on all of the data. So what master node does is automatically copies this job, the task, and transfers this to all of these machines. Basically, in the earlier scenario, in the traditional scenario, we are basically moving the data. In this case, we are just moving the code to different machine, and I don't need to go to different machine and run that. This master will basically take care of that. And the one more advantage is the master knows how many machines are there in the cluster, and it automatically knows who has how much power and who has how much data. So basically this master will take care of giving equal job to all of these machines. So I don't need to really worry about, okay, which machine is faster, which is slower. The master will basically knows that, and he takes care of distributing jobs. And the other thing is, even if some machine fails, the job which this machine was supposed to compute will be redistributed to other machines. So the job will be redistributed. So we are sure that no matter what happens to the machines in the cluster, we will definitely get the job and our results back. And the one more thing is, I don't need to go back to all of the machines to collect the results, because the master will do that, okay? All of the job which I did in the traditional method, the master will do that for me. So the master will basically collect all of the results, and then it also knows how to aggregate the results and give it to me. So that's the beauty of, you know, using MapReduce framework. Not just MapReduce framework, basically there are a lot of, you know, big data batch processing and stream processing frameworks are there, like Spark, Storm, Flink, Kafka Streams. All of this basically does the same thing, okay? The manual task as a person or the administrator of the machines or the problem giver, which I'm supposed to do, all of this will be done by the framework itself. You just need to write the business logic, what you have to do it. And the reliability, the durability, and the distribution of the job, and you know, maintenance of these machines will all be taken care of by the master itself. So let's understand what is MapReducing. First of all, MapReducing is the process of, you know, executing all of the, you know, big problems in parallel and in distributed manner to get some result. That's what actually MapReduce means. So we have discussed how it works with respect to servers and everything. So now this diagram, basically you will find it all over the internet with the same example. I'm also picking up the same example. Maybe if you go back and read some tutorials, you will get better understanding also. So as the name itself indicates, there is something called as mapping and reducing. So whenever you have the input, maybe a big data or big input, you have to first map, and then after you map, you basically have to reduce to get the result. So that what, you know, word count is the very good example to explain the MapReduce. This is the core of all the, you know, distributed processing frameworks. That's the reason you need to understand. This Google had used MapReduce extensively, you know, a couple of years back, but now we have even high-level frameworks available which actually gives even better features than MapReduce. So, but still, it's better to understand this, so you will have much better understanding of the other frameworks. Say, what happens in MapReduce is, whenever you have the input, automatically, as I mentioned, the data is kind of already split and stored into the different cluster. But even though if you don't have the data saved already, even if you give the fresh data, automatically the framework will split the data into some chunks. We don't really know on what strategy. Based on some strategy, it basically splits the data. Say you have this data here, deer, bear, river, car, river, deer, car, bear, and everything. It is basically splitting into some data into chunks, and that's what is called as split state. Split stage, okay, and all of this data, now the actual map reducing job actually happens. You know, all of these steps all happens in every machine because the data is already present in that machine locally, because the split data is already there in the machine. So all of this job should happen on the same machine. The mapping, shuffle, and reduce, all of this should happen. So what happens in mapping is, we know what we need to map. Basically, we are trying to you know, find the count or unique count of the word in all of the books, right? So what happens is, we need to map it to the very basic value. So every word in here in the sentence, we'll have to assign value. The basic value for the count is, the default value is 1, right? So for every word in here, we'll have to assign that value. So that's what happens in the mapping stage. So we are not concerned about counting it, or we are not concerned about aggregating it at all. Even though there are duplicates, just assign a very basic value. So for every word here, we are assigned 1, 1, 1. So same thing. So here, if you see, there are two words called car. Still, we are assigning 1, 1, and river, and everything. So this is a blind mapping of each word into one value. So this happened. And now what happens is, now we'll have to kind of group them together, because the values are kind of distributed across different machines. We don't know where, but definitely it is happening in parallel computation. So it is distributed across the machines. Now we need to group all of them. That is what called as shuffle phase. We basically shuffle all of this mapped data to group them together. So now all of the, you know, words of a kind will go into one place. Maybe this is happening in one machine and this is happening in one machine, or maybe this in 1, 1, 1. We never know. But definitely all of the stages will happen in all of the machines. Otherwise, there will be no efficiency. So now if you see here there are deer, one word, bear, and river. So bear has gone here, deer is gone here. So actually, I have to draw that one. So deer has gone here, and river has gone here. Similarly, car has gone here, river has gone here similarly. So all of this is shuffled, and now here if you see, all of similar kind of words are grouped together, but still it is not aggregated. That's what the reduce phase is for. When we have grouped it, now it's a stage where we compress it or aggregate or reduce it to the counts. Now we have two bear, so bear the count is 2, and similarly car 3, deer 2, and river 2. Now the final stage, add all of the results we have got so far, and then we get the output. So this is what the word count, initially we gave the sentence with all of the different words, first split, and then we'll have to map to the basic value, and then we'll have to shuffle or group it, and then we reduce it, and then we aggregate all of that to get the output. So this is how the map reduce happens. So all of the modern frameworks are based on this logic itself. Now, let's see what are the different kind of frameworks which we have to solve